Good morning, students. Today we are going to start lesson 2 of political science, grade 10, that is federalism. In the previous chapter, that is power sharing, we noted that vertical division of power among different levels of government is one of the major forms of power sharing in modern democracies. In this chapter, we'll focus on this form of power sharing. This is commonly referred to as federalism. The topics which would be covered in this lesson are: what is federalism, features of federalism, types of federalism, characteristics of Indian federalism, federalism practiced in India, and decentralization in India. We begin by describing federalism in general terms. The rest of the chapter tries to understand the theory and practice of federalism in India. A discussion of the federal constitutional provisions is followed by an analysis of the policies and politics that has strengthened federalism in practice. Towards the end of the lesson, we turn to the local government, a new and the third tier of Indian federalism. So let's start the lesson by understanding the meaning of the word federalism. What do we mean by this word? Now, federalism is a system of government in which the power is divided between a central authority and various constituent units of the country. Usually, a federation has two levels of government. Both these levels of government enjoy their power independent of the other. Now, in India, when we say that we have two levels of government, it is the central and the state government which we are talking about. But as we discussed in the previous lesson, the state government has got another set of three levels of government, which is called as the Panchayati Raj, which would be discussed at the end of this lesson. Now, there are different levels of the government. There are countries which has got only one level of the government. There are countries which has got two levels of government. We studied about Belgium, where there was a third setup of government. Now, there can be government for the entire country. There can be government at the level of the provinces, state, and both the government, both the different levels of the government enjoy independent power. State government has power of its own and it's not answerable to the center. This is a type of government which is practiced in United States of America. Into our country also we have the state government, but yes, they are answerable to the central government. Now, we read about what is federal government. There is another set of government which is called as a unitary government, where there is only one level of government and all the other subunits are subordinate. Subordinate means they are under that level of the government, and that superior level of government is called as the central government, and it can pass orders to the local government. For example, United Kingdom. Now, our constitution, when it was framed, it took into account the good points of various constitutions of the world. But yes, since we were ruled by the Britishers, our constitution is very much influenced by the UK, the constitution of United Kingdom. I hope you have understood the meaning of federalism. Now let's study what are the very features of federalism. First feature, it has got two or more levels of government, as we studied earlier, central government and state government. But in India, we have a third level of government called as the Panchayati Raj. Each level has its own powers and jurisdiction. That is, the central government has got its own powers and jurisdiction, and the state government has got its own powers and jurisdiction. But at the same time, the central government can give orders to the state government as and when necessary, and the state government is supposed to follow the orders passed by the central government. Jurisdiction is specified by the constitution, and there is constitutional guarantee of authority. Jurisdiction means the area through which you can exercise your powers. So jurisdiction is specified. The central government's area of power is specified and the state government's area of power is specified in the constitution. Constitutional provisions can be changed only with the consent of both levels of government. That is, anything which has to be brought about a change in the constitution can be done only with the consent of both the central government and the state government. The court interprets the constitution and powers of different levels of government. Supreme Court acts as the umpire if disputes arise with different levels of government. So the court is the one which interprets the entire constitution. As we know, Supreme Court is considered as the highest court. So if there is any dispute between two states, then it is the Supreme Court which resolves the issue. The sources of revenue are clearly specified. Revenue means the money which the central and the state government get. So what kind of taxes goes to the central government, what kind of taxes would go to the state government are very clearly specified into the constitutional provisions. And the federal system thus has dual objective: to safeguard and promote unity of the country while at the same time accommodate regional diversity. Means in this kind of a government, it has got two work to be done. First is to promote the unity of the country. It has to see that the country stands united. At the same time, it also has to see that people belonging to different region are accommodated well within the social setup. Now, this is the continuation of the last point where we said that the federal government has dual objective. Therefore, two aspects become very crucial for the institutions and practice of federalism. First, that the government at different levels should agree to some rules of power sharing. They should also trust that each would abide by its part of the agreement. So, an ideal federal system has both aspects: mutual trust and agreement to live together and peacefully. Now let's do the last aspect of part one of federalism, that is the types of federalism. The exact balance of power between the central and the state government varies from one federation to another. This balance depends mainly on the historical context in which the federation was formed. Different countries have a different historical background in which they were formed, and on that basis the kind of federation they have it. There are two kinds of route through which federations have been formed. The first route involves independent states coming together on their own to form a bigger unit, so that by pooling their own sovereignty and retaining their identity, they can increase their security. This type of coming together federation includes the USA, Switzerland, and Australia. In this first category of federation, all the constituent states usually have equal power and are strong vis-a-vis the federal government. Now, the second route is where a large country decides to divide its power between the constituent state and the national government. India, Spain, Belgium are example of this kind of holding together federation. In this second category, the central government tends to be more powerful than the state government. Very often, different constituent units of the federation have unequal powers. Some units are granted special powers. Like into our country also, some states like Jammu and Kashmir were given some extra powers into the constitution, because that was decided at the time of independence itself. Now let's discuss the question answers which you need to write into your notebooks. The first question: what is federalism? Discuss its main levels. I have already given the answer, so those who wish to copy this answer can copy this answer. Those who want to write it in their own words can carry out in that manner. Now, in this answer, first you have to write the meaning of federalism and then say about the different levels. In federalism, power is divided between a central authority and various constituent units of the country. Federalism has two levels of government. One is the government for the entire country that is usually responsible for few subjects of common national interest, and the other are governments at the level of provinces or states that look after much of the day-to-day administering of their state. Second question, differentiate between a unitary and a federal government. In a unitary form of government, the central government is supreme and can pass any order to the state or local government on any specific issues, example, United Kingdom. In a federal system of government, the central government is not authorized to instruct the state government on any particular issue because the central and the state government enjoy their independent powers, for example, the government of United States of America. Next question, what objectives does the federal government strive to attain? We discussed it earlier that it has got dual objective to maintain the unity as well as to accommodate the regional diversity. So you'll have to write both the objectives of the federal form of government. Now there's an assignment also which I have given, which you need to write it in your notebook. Discuss the key features of federalism, and the second one, differentiate between coming together and holding together federalism. This has already been discussed in the slides, so you can write it from there itself. So altogether, in this part of the lesson, you had 5 questions which needs to be written into your notebooks. 3 I have already given and 2 goes as a homework. Thank you all. There are 2 more parts of this lesson. I hope this part was clear. Anyways, if you have any doubt, do send me a WhatsApp message or you can call me up to clear your doubt. But please ensure that you are doing up the lesson. If you require a video session for this, do let me know so that I can arrange for an online live class also. Thank you all. God bless you.